seems like a thing. Okay, so I work for a company in London called Wonzo. I'm Simon VC on Twitter if you want to send me any feedback. I work with this group of people. For the last 2 years, we've been building a brand new bank from scratch. Not using anybody else's software, we decided to start completely from a clean slate and build all of the software ourselves to build a new bank. This is a picture of our office. We're still very much a startup. We're a very small company with a very terrible office. But we have now, for the last 12 months, been running a MasterCard prepaid debit card in advance of getting our banking license, which we now have. We'll be launching a full bank next year. So in a little bit over 2 years, we've built a whole bank from scratch with no legacy systems at all brand new. I want to start with a question. Does anybody know or want to take a guess what these four numbers are? Anyone? Anyone? Sorry? No. These are, believe it or not, the years the big four banks in London were founded. Banking is a really, really old industry. And London banks are probably some of the oldest banks in the world. And banking hasn't really changed very much since banks looked like this. If you went back to 1860 when this picture was taken, they would let you open a current account, they would give you a little pay-in book, and they would write in your bank balance. But broadly, the way interest is paid and calculated, and the products they would sell haven't really changed very much since the 1860s. And bank IT hasn't changed very much since computers looked like this. One of the file formats that we have to deal with is called the ICD format. And we were looking at it the other day and trying to work out why the last 8 characters of this particular file have to be this weird string of characters, and nobody can really understand why. And it turns out, after a bit of digging, that the last 4 characters of this particular file create a bit pattern that goes up and down like this that tells this tape drive where to stop. And it's still, in 2016, built into the file format that the banks used to send messages to and from ATMs. Like, so a typical bank, not us, but a typical bank, they use these fixed width files. They use a file format called EBCDIC, which is sort of pre-ASCII. It's when you could only encode, you encoded everything with 7 bits, so it was just uppercase letters. This, by the way, who's here is over the age of 50? Is anyone here over 50 years old? Okay, no. So do you know why people who are older than 50, why they always type in capital letters? It's because computers didn't used to have lowercase letters. They only used to have capital letters. And that's why you'll see things like Oracle Database. You'll see they always type the commands in capital letters. It's because computers didn't used to have lowercase letters. And they typically, these banks typically, they use layers around the central infrastructure. So the central infrastructure is a mainframe, it's the ultimate monolith, and they just build caching and more systems around this monolith. So we decided to start again from scratch, because there's some things that traditional banks or legacy banks can't do. There's a reason you can't generally search for your transaction history, because they don't keep that online. They only keep sort of 3 months online. Your bank statement has this like only 18 characters, then it's cut off. That's because they store fixed width files. The system's called MT. Right, yeah. Does anybody think I need to be louder?
No.
Well, great. Now even louder.
Sure. Now I have to talk more quietly. It won't be as fun.
Yeah, and there's no way.
Oh, God, it's so loud. I'm going to put it down here, and then I'm just going to talk about it. Is that right?
Yeah.
So, and there's no API. So banks don't generally have APIs, and that's something that makes me sad. So we decided to start again and build everything in Go, so you can use Unicode. We think banking should look more like this. Banking should be something that you can use anywhere you want. Like, you can be out on the road, you should do everything you want on your mobile phone. You should never need to go into a branch. We don't have any branches, so you couldn't go into a branch anyway. We've built a lovely modern Android app and an iOS app. It looks like this. We've already got things like targets and bill splitting and send and receive money and all of the sorts of things we've been able to build very quickly. would typically be sort of a 5-year roadmap for big banks. We can do it in sort of, you know, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, and get stuff live in production. So it's working really well. We also think banking should look like this. You should have an API. Like, we have an open API. Everybody who has a bank account can basically go to our developer portal and get an API key, and you can make RESTful API requests and get back beautiful structured JSON. Looks like this. There's absolutely no XML anywhere in our system. I promise you, we'll never send you back XML. So what I'm going to do today is talk about the DevOps journey at Monzo. We're only a 2-year-old company, but because we have no legacy, we've been pretty free to select the technology that we wanted to use. And we've chosen some interesting pieces of technology. Probably too many interesting pieces of technology. We've sort of crammed them all in together. I will show you some of them. So back in 2014, when we started Monzo, we asked the regulator, they called the FCA, the Financial Conduct Authority in London, we asked them, can we use the cloud? And they said, maybe, but probably not. They said, there's some regulation that means that you probably won't be allowed to use the cloud. The actual regulation that was going to stop us from using Amazon was that the regulator required the ability to go and visit the data center. The regulator wanted to go and look at our computers. And we asked Amazon, and they just laughed at us and said, no, you can't come and look at our computers. So we complained a bit to the FCA. And in 2015, they said they would think about it. And in 2016, they said, go for it. So we put it in our business plan, and we submitted it to the Financial Conduct Authority, and they said yes. And I'm like, yes. So we are the first bank to have been granted permission to operate on Amazon Web Services, which is pretty cool. But it immediately presented a problem for us. When you get a banking license and you want to connect to the banking system, you have to connect to the other banks. And the other banks basically, they don't really trust the internet, they don't really know how it works. So they wanted to bring leased lines, so fiber optic connections, to us. And they asked us what the address of our data centers were, where they could bring the fiber optic cables and plug them in. And we, of course, had this problem. We couldn't just tell them we were using Amazon. So we thought about it for a while, and then we got a switch and put it in a data center, and we connected all the banks to that port. And we connected Amazon to that port. And we now have two of these like redundant points of presence, we call them. We also decided very early on that we would build using microservices from the outset. Does anybody know what this? This is the fail whale. This is the reason, when you're starting at a new company, it's actually a good idea to optimize for developer productivity. When you start a company, you want to very quickly work out whether or not that company is going to be successful or not. And you don't want to over-engineer things in the early days. You don't over-engineer things because it might be that your business is never going to work. So you didn't need to build a giant scalable solution. You could have just built a Ruby on Rails or a Python and Flask app and proved your idea. But I think that's what Twitter did. Twitter built the original version of Twitter in Ruby. And of course, every time it would go over capacity, it would fall over. But we decided that you'd only get one chance at people's money. Like, if people go to pay for lunch, doesn't work, then they go to another bank and they'll never use you again. So we couldn't really afford to have what we call the fail whale phase. So we decided we would use Go microservices from the outset. So our stack looks like this now. We use Golang. Who here codes in Go? Yeah, the rest of you learn Go. It's awesome. It's really, really good. For a DevOps person, Go is beautiful because the end result for us are about 11 to 22 megabyte single file binaries you just drop on a box and they work. Before I came to work at Monzo, I was working at a place that used Java, and we would have to move 1.4 gigabytes of JVM and JAR files and WebLogic and associated cruft. So I really like Golang, it's beautiful. We use a thing called Linkerd, which I think people are going to hear a lot more about in the future. I think it's an amazing piece of technology. It's basically a HTTP proxy that does service discovery for you. So a lot of people talk about using console, which is a key value store with a DNS backend, or they talk about using etcd, or they talk about some homegrown solution for doing service discovery. But what we did instead is we use linkerd, so all of our services only talk to localhost, to the proxy, and linkerd basically sorts out the routing so that the request arrives at some place. And it's really nice if you're building your own code, because every language has a HTTP client. It doesn't matter if you're writing Go, or Python, or Ruby, it just doesn't matter. As long as you can make a HTTP request, you can send your request to Linkerd, and it will forward it to the correct place. We're using Docker and Kubernetes, because everybody is. But I'll talk more about Kubernetes in a little bit. And we use NSQ for asynchronous messaging. There's a lot of messaging that happens in the bank. It doesn't have to happen in real time. You might make a, like, when a request comes in, we just basically store it, put it on NSQ, and then deal with it, you know, in the next 5 or 10 seconds with NSQ for that. And we use Cassandra as our primary data store. We are very aware of the eventual consistency around Cassandra, and we're actually very happy with eventual consistency. A lot of people say to us, like, you can't keep a person's bank balance in Cassandra, that's crazy. Yeah. But you really, really can. You really can. Your bank balance is already eventually consistent. Because all of the other banks, they have, the way they actually work is they ingest files, and then they apply those files to an account. And like the files that come from the ATM machines and from MasterCard and Visa, they all come at different times of the day. And some of them come 2 times a day, and some of them come 4 times a day. And then when they get those files, they don't always process them like immediately. Sometimes they'll process them at the end of the day, or they'll process them at 3 o'clock in the morning. So your bank balance is already an eventually consistent log of all of the things that have happened, all of the financial transactions that have happened. So we just use Cassandra for that. And we are very careful to use read your own write consistency to make sure that we don't overwrite a low balance with a high balance when it should be a low balance. So in the early days, we started off using Marathon on top of Mesos. Who's used, anyone here use Marathon? Cool. So Marathon's all right. Mesos is fine. It just predates Docker. And so the Docker executor is not as well developed as the Kubernetes Docker executor. Marathon had a lot of problems 2 years ago. It was very easy to make Marathon fall over, and when it did fall over, we would have problems with Zookeeper and getting the data corrupted. And we very quickly grew to many, many, many services, and we found Marathon just wasn't really coping. Kubernetes basically started to fix all of the problems that we had, and the momentum seemed to be with Kubernetes. So we've just done a 3-month project to move everything onto Kubernetes away from Marathon. So we no longer run Marathon. This is what our Kubernetes dashboard looks like. If you haven't seen Kubernetes, I just thought I'd include a picture of it. It's nice that we don't really use very much. We mostly use kubectl, the Kubernetes command line client. But there is a dashboard there, it gives you a nice warm fuzzy feeling, you can see the green ticks if you want it. The other thing that we decided very early on in the process of building Monzo was that we wanted one API for everything. Like, a lot of banks will have discrete systems for different things. They'll have like the lending system, and the mortgage system, and the monitoring system, and the customer care system, and they connect all of those systems together using service-oriented architecture by making calls between those systems. But we didn't want to do that. What we wanted to do instead was to put everything behind one unified API. So we just have one API. And that API, like the app on my phone, like the client app, uses the same API as the, like when messages come in from the credit card companies, it uses the same API. Our customer care tooling uses the same API, and our DevOps tooling uses the same API as well. So it's all the same API. Like, everything talks to this same API endpoint. I've just blurred it out because this is the internal one, but it's actually the same API. It's the same API endpoint. one of the nice things about this is that we have a command line tool. We have a CLI for our own bank. And it's hard to explain how cool that is. But any one of our microservices, like is a service platform authentication, the endpoint is read user, and you can see that like our internal tooling uses the exact same they're saying to Lazarus.
It's not required. It's for video recording.
Ah. Oh. What's that again? Sorry. So it's not so loud.
I don't want to deafen everybody.
So we have one API that we use for everything. You can see here, like using the same API to talk to our authentication service. I can also talk to our config service and just change things like the Cassandra timeout. It's all the same API, which is pretty cool. Our internal tooling uses the same API. So our customer care agents, our people who work on our BizOps database, it also uses the same backend API. And this is another system that uses the same API. This is called Slog. Who uses a microservices architecture now? Okay. So one of the things that is hard about microservices is that you lose some of the you don't by default have the same ability to jump on the machine and look at the logs. And it becomes a lot harder to work out what happened, especially if you're using something like Kubernetes. And if a service dies, Kubernetes reschedules it on a different machine. It can sometimes be difficult to go find the logs of the pod that doesn't exist anymore. So we use this thing called Slog, which is our structured logging system. And basically, it's using the same API, but all of our services actually emit structured logging, and every request either has a thing called a trace ID or it creates a trace ID. So as soon as you see an error anywhere in the system, you can just grab a trace ID and put it in there, and you can see the entire flow through the whole system. It's really, really cool. We also recently moved our build process into Kubernetes and behind the same API, which is kind of cool. We did this because we're very happy with Kubernetes namespaces. It lets us separate our build from our production workload, but run them on the same machines. So it means that when you want to build a production container, you can build that container using the spare CPU cycles on the same machines where it's going to run. And it means that we have a much higher utilization. We have a good workload that can soak up free CPU cycles. And it means that we're building our build artifacts on secure machines that we're very confident about the security of. So again, in the same API, our build process. So we managed to finally slay Jenkins. We build all of this using Terraform. Who uses Terraform already? No? No one using Terraform? Really? One person using Terraform? Cool. Okay. So you should definitely look at Terraform. I thought more people would have used Terraform. Terraform is a declarative language. It's made by HashiCorp, people who make console, among other things. And it's very, very good. Who uses CloudFormation on Amazon? No one? Okay. You know Amazon CloudFormation? No? Okay. It's the idea is that you can declare what your architecture should look like, what machines you should have, and what they should be running. And it's a nice way of keeping a description of your architecture in Git, and you can sort of plan changes and apply parts of changes, and you can keep your config for your whole architecture in Git. There's some things that aren't very good about Terraform that we've come up against after using it for a few months. There's no way to suppress parts of the architecture. So do you remember when I showed you that picture of the physical equipment that we use to plug in the banks? Well, we would like to have some way of saying to Terraform, that doesn't exist in staging. In our staging environment, there's no physical box, so there's no BGP loops. But Terraform doesn't have the ability to turn off parts, which is lacking. And there's this idea of TF state, which is the current state of your infrastructure, like what is currently there. Terraform keeps that in files, which you then check into Git, which is really annoying if you have more than one person who wants to work on the same infrastructure. So that's not good things about Terraform, but we still use it. Terraform is being improved very quickly, and I want to highlight two things that I'm really excited about. One is that in the new version of Terraform, you can actually import your existing infrastructure. So if you already have Amazon Web Services and you already have a lot of infrastructure, you'll be able to actually pull that into Terraform and get configuration that you can then manage using Terraform. So that's coming in the next version of Terraform. There's also a Ruby gem, which is confusingly called Terraforming, that will do this for you now. So if you want to play with Terraform, if you're already using AWS and you want to get a feel for Terraform, the easiest way to start is to do gem install Terraforming and just run it with an AWS key, and it will give you a complete Terraform script for your existing infrastructure that you can then apply or modify. But do care. I want to talk a little bit about Kubernetes, which we call K8S because Kubernetes is too long to write out every time. This was our AWS cost. This is how much money we were spending at Amazon. This is like when we switched to Kubernetes, we could basically start to turn off our old infrastructure. And basically that part can be turned off straight away was our build infrastructure because we moved build into Kubernetes. So we immediately saved a bunch of money there. And then slowly we turned off all of the old infrastructure. So now we're about here as well. So Kubernetes has saved us a lot of money as well by allowing us to utilize our machines at a much higher level. Kubernetes has a command line tool called kubectl, and it has two really useful commands that I've come to rely on a lot, which is kubectl1 and kubectl exec. If you imagine for a second that this said Docker run instead of kubectl, what this does is this sort of passes commands through as if they were Docker commands. So you can run a container, like a BusyBox, inside your Kubernetes cluster, and it will just drop you into it. And you don't have any idea where in your cluster that's running, but it just randomly starts a container and connects you to it. It's like magic. Really good. So that's one really useful command that we found. We also use kubectl exec to, like, if you get really confused about like what's happening inside a container, and you want to know like what version's been deployed or whether the container was built successfully, you can use exec, like Docker exec, but kubectl exec, to drop into the namespace of that actual instance, even if it's on a machine somewhere in the Kubernetes cluster. You have no idea where, but you can get a shell inside that container, and you can very quickly work out what's going on. So really useful commands in Kubernetes. The kubectl allows you to edit the running config. So a typical workflow might be if you want to make changes to the configuration of a system, you would do something like kubectl edit pod, and then the definition of that particular pod. This is a little bit dangerous. I put this on here because we, as a team, are struggling to decide when it's appropriate to make changes in production or when it's better to keep the definitions of Kubernetes pods or Kubernetes deployments in Git and then always reapply them. It's the classic DevOps thing. Like, should you make changes in production or should you reapply the changes that are in Git? And this is a question that's come up again and again for us in been using kubectl edit. And there's a few things that are still missing from Kubernetes that aren't quite ready yet or aren't quite finished. Scheduling. There's no cron in Kubernetes yet. It is coming. So what we actually do is we actually run the cron daemon in Kubernetes. We run a container, a Docker container, with cron running in the foreground mode. And we build it, and we just use that. We actually run cron inside a container, inside Kubernetes. The overlay networks that we're using at the moment, they're not really encrypted overlay networks. They're just IP tables rules that bounce packets around. We would be much happier if the overlay network was encrypted, because when you're using Amazon Web Services, the traffic between availability zones is passing over fiber optic connections, and we would prefer that that traffic would be encrypted on the wire. So we will switch to an encrypted overlay network when one becomes available. Persistent storage is still a bit new in Kubernetes. That's coming, so you can run things like databases inside Kubernetes. And the one thing that I missed from Mesos, from Marathon, is that the dashboard doesn't update live. When you make a change, Mesos or Marathon has this lovely little live update, so you can see things being deprovisioned and you can see them being reprovisioned. But with Kubernetes, I always have to hit reload. So it's a small thing, but it annoys me. Kubernetes has also meant that we can more safely run heterogeneous containers. So whereas in Marathon we would only run Go binaries because we were dropping the Go binaries on the actual box, we didn't want to have to install any dependencies on the box. With Kubernetes, because we're running in Docker, we're much more comfortable building services now in Python or even Bash. Like the cron container is a, in a way, it's a service. It's running in a container. It doesn't receive any data, but it does on a schedule poke an API. So we have a microservice running in Bash, which is kind of cool. I think it's probably we're probably the first people to run Bash microservices. And there's a few things that we haven't yet felt comfortable to put into containers. I can't actually see my list, but you can see my list here. We haven't put Jenkins in containers yet. There are a few things that we still use Jenkins for, jobs that don't fit in other places. We haven't put Cassandra in Kubernetes yet. And for those things, we are deploying using Puppet to Ubuntu. So we still have a small amount of traditional DevOps tooling to deploy things to Ubuntu. I want to talk a little bit about security, especially around using Amazon Web Services to run a bank. The regulator asked us a lot of questions around the security of running a bank on AWS, as you can imagine. We talked to Amazon Web Services about this, to AWS, and this was the best piece of advice that they ever gave us. Run multiple AWS accounts. If you haven't seen this before, you can link AWS accounts together. So we have a production account, a non-production account, an account for building things, an account for mobile things, and they're all linked. There's actually another account called users. The users account has nothing in it except definitions of users. But there's a role that allows you to log in and add into the users account, and then you can switch to the other accounts. And this actually turns out to be really nice. Like, does anybody here work in a place that has multiple AWS accounts now? Okay. So it gives me great comfort to know that, for example, the production instances, the backups for the production instances are not in the same AWS account as the production instances. Because if somebody ever goes crazy, or if we have, like, somebody hacks in and, like, deletes everything in one of our, like, deletes our AWS account, we at least know they will only have deleted either the backups or the production, but not the backups and the production. So it's a really good idea to have multiple AWS accounts and to link them together. We use hardware like tokens for the root accounts. And these actually live in a safe. And when we go into production, they will actually live in a safety deposit box at another bank. And we will split our team into half, and no one will have access to all of the root accounts. Like, some people will have access to production, some people will have access to audit or backups, but no one will have access to everything. So no single person will be able to shut down all of our infrastructure or to corrupt all of our infrastructure or all of our logs. There's a tool that I wanted to highlight as well. It's called AWS Profile. It's a little, I guess it's written in Go, I'm not really sure. It's a little tool that makes it much easier to manage multiple Amazon accounts. So a lot of the AWS tooling, like the AWS command line tooling, it already understands multiple AWS accounts or AWS profiles. But a lot of the tools like Terraform and other tools that use AWS don't yet understand AWS multiple AWS accounts. So this AWS profile tool wraps those tools and basically provides the AWS key and secret to those tools in a way that they can understand. And it's very useful. It made our life a lot easier once we discovered it. And the reason you want to be really, really careful if you're a developer working at a bank and using Terraform is Terraform is terrifying. If you built the production infrastructure, it sort of means that you, by definition, had access to the AWS keys that created all of the bank's machines, which means that if you screw up, like, those keys are still on your computer, if somebody can steal those keys, then they can delete all of your bank. And that's, like, scary. That keeps me up at night. So what we discovered is a really good tool is a password manager called Pass. Did anyone use 1Password? Yeah, if you don't use 1Password, get 1Password. It's really, really good. But Pass is a command line tool. It's a command line password manager. And it's scriptable. So you can put it inside a bash script. And it uses GPG. So it uses your GPG key to encrypt your AWS keys. And you can keep your GPG key on a YubiKey. Do you guys know what a YubiKey is? Yeah, so a YubiKey, for those of you who haven't heard of it, is a tiny little hardware security module. It's about that big, and it lives in your USB port. And because it can talk to GPG, it means that if somebody hacks into the computer, and they try to steal the AWS keys off my computer, they won't be able to, because those keys are encrypted using Pass and a GPG key, and the GPG key that encrypted those keys is on a physical hardware token. So you would actually have to steal my whole computer with the YubiKey plugged into it, and get my password out of my head, and decrypt File Vault to get those keys and join them together.
Slow roll, please.
Sorry. Yeah, so these three things together, Pass, and GBG and YubiKeys mean that I'm confident that the AWS keys that we used to launch our infrastructure will not be compromised. I'd like to talk a little bit about the monitoring. There's been some really good talks at this conference about monitoring and about metrics. We used in the early days Elasticsearch. It was with Logstash and Kibana to get graphs. It's sometimes called the ELK stack. We have stopped using that now and moved to the TIC stack, which is Telegraph, InfluxDB, Chronograph, and Capacitor. But we don't use Chronograph, we use Grafana instead. So it will be the TIGK stack. But the main point of that is to give us pretty graphs like this. You can't overemphasize how useful it is having graphs like this when you want to find out what's gone wrong or what's causing problems. This is more about our graphs. InfluxDB is a very immature product though, and we switched to it about 3 months ago, and I can't honestly recommend it yet. It has a tendency to fall over at the worst possible time. So, like, when we all jump on the machine to look at the to look at some graphs to find out what's gone wrong, the fact that we're all looking at InfluxDB at the same time has a tendency to make InfluxDB fall over, which is really inconvenient. So we may move away from InfluxDB, unfortunately. And the other thing that's been a real challenge for us is how we test a negative. Like, particularly, when you're a small startup like us, we want to be alerted if no card transactions are happening. If no one is making transactions or no one is spending money, then how do we know if we're up or if we're down? It might just be 3 o'clock in the morning and everybody's asleep, or it might be that we're not getting, we've lost a connection to a we've lost our data center, or we've lost a connection to MasterCard. So Chronograph has this string processing system that it can alert you on events, but it also has this concept of a dead bands switch. That is, if it doesn't see any data for a period of time, then it will alert you. And this is what we use. We use dead band. But there's still the potential that maybe the reason it's not seeing any data is because nobody's making any transactions. So one of our, not us, I wish it was us, one of our competitors built this, and this is how they make sure that there are always transactions happening, so that they're alerted if there are no transactions. This is very wasteful, though, because it costs, every time the train goes around, it costs about 50p, like 50 pence. So we didn't do that. We won't do that. Instead, what we do, which is much more sensible, is we just have an alert that says that if no transaction has happened for more than 1 minute, then make a transaction. And if no transaction has happened for 2 minutes, then ring PagerDuty and wake somebody up. This is a much cheaper way of doing the alerting. So, summing up, we have built a bank in less than 2 years using Go primarily. We're running on Kubernetes and Docker. We're using a single API for everything. Everything is behind a single API, including all of our logging and our build processes and our business processes. As well as our system management processes. It's all one single unified API. And we're pretty well covered by monitoring, although we're still planning on improving that in the future. So hopefully I didn't talk too quickly. Does anybody have any questions?
Storing the bank account in the Cassandra, this is mind-blowing, but my question is, why you use Kubernetes and not Docker Swarm?
I made a list of my dream framework. I put everything that I wanted on my dream framework. I wanted an artifact repository, I wanted an overlay network, I wanted optimistic scheduling, so it would over-provision things onto the machines. I wanted a really good community. I wanted to know that it was going to be supported. I haven't found a framework that did everything. I looked at Nomad as well. HashiCorp's Nomad is another competitor. There was no framework that did everything that I wanted. But I was most confident with the trajectory of Kubernetes. I was most confident with the size of the developer community, the speed with which they were developing features, and it was good enough at the time. Whereas Docker Swarm, yeah, I like Google, honestly. I like what they're building.
Thank you very much for your talk. It was really excited. And I noticed that you are using, at the moment, really cutting-edge technology set, but you are still using Jenkins.
Yeah.
Have you tried to look, for example, GitLab CI, Concourse CI, and go...
I did look at Concourse CI, I did.
Yeah.
Concourse CI, do you know the expression yak shaving? Does that make sense? Okay, so yak shaving is when you want to do one thing, but to do that thing, you have to learn something else, and then you go over here and you're like, oh, I have to learn something else. And I started looking at Concourse CI, and it was tied into some weird deployment mechanism, and then it was tied into some other thing, and it just went like this. And what we needed was very, very simple. Very simple. Because we're only building Go microservices primarily. We just have a make file, and we call go get go build, and we take the resulting file, and we put it in a Docker scratch container, and we push that to a Docker registry. Like, it's literally five things. It's five lines in a make file, and it takes like 5 seconds to run. So we didn't really need the power of Jenkins. We actually use Jenkins more for scheduling machine learning jobs. And not because we have a good reason for that, just because it was much easier to give like teams that had specific needs, just give them a Jenkins and let them go do what they want.
We just used already Concourse CI, and we had a lot of pain with that because it's pretty slow. And it's why I ask you. And have you looked at the Jenkins 2 version?
We're using Jenkins 2 now.
Already?
And we're using Jenkins pipeline plugin.
Pipeline?
Yeah. We use it, like I said, mostly for machine learning. I think probably the most complicated build that we do is we build the Android app using Jenkins because it's a Java build process. So we still use that Jenkins for that.
And how much time takes one build in minutes?
No idea. Like, I know that the machine learning builds take up as much time as we give them. Like, they take an hour to build. The Android build, I don't know. I would have to ask the Android team. Probably like 10 minutes.
Great. Thank you.
Any more questions? Sure.
One more question about deployment. Okay. How do you deploy? Do you use Kubernetes deployments?
Yes.
Roll updates. Do you? You do it manually? Just YAML file uploaded to
if it's the,
kubectl.
Yeah, we're still talking about this, about the best way to do this. The process that we want to enable is we want developers to be able to safely deploy their new things into production. One of the beautiful things about microservices, especially microservices that use protobufs and Linkerd, is that it's quite safe to put a new thing into production because nothing will talk to it until you've told something else to talk to it. So we want to make it so that it's very easy for developers to run their code into production. So what we do is we have a templating system that builds the YAML file for a Kubernetes deployment. And they check that out, they create the deployment YAML, and they push that into production. And then if they want to make changes to change the number of instances that are running, or like change where it's deployed, or change how much traffic it gets, they're allowed to go kubectl edit, and edit that live in the production system. And then we just try to ask people to keep the YAML definition of their deployment up to date in Git. But it's not good, it's not a good process yet.
Thank you.
Next team.
Okay, thank you for your talk. I'm quite impressed you run it on AWS, but what about security and pen testing? How you guys get away from it?
So the regulator said to us that they were happy for us to run on AWS as long as we followed Amazon's recommendations about security. Mm. And Amazon came to us, and we worked very closely with Amazon. And there's a gentleman in London, they call him Scary Dave. he's an old school hacker, and he wears like a black trench coat. He's got hair down here, and he comes to your office, and he basically stands there and goes, "You must do this, and you must do this, and you must do this." And the things that he told us were like use multiple accounts and have the audit bucket, like things right across accounts, so that, like, no one has the ability to modify the audit bucket. So when transactions come in, for example, we write them to an S3 bucket in a different AWS account that none of us have access to. Like, as soon as they hit the edge, they get written into a different AWS account. So if somebody ever decides to mess around with Cassandra and change my bank balance to 100 million, it's not going to matter, because we have a separate system that I can't access that has the original intent, like the original information is coming to them. More worrying, like, so from a security point, like from a not losing all of our money and going out of business, I think we're quite happy with the setup right now. Like, we don't run a lot of software that we've, but there's no, because we wrote everything ourselves, and we only used like Go, and we only used Go's HTTP libraries. It's the only thing on the internet. I don't think there's a big attack surface, like, to attack us from outside.
So not so many people attack Golang. Yeah.
Yeah, but if somebody attacks Golang and finds a hole in net HTTP, then the whole internet would be broken anyway, so it won't matter. Yeah. But more worrying for us is the risk of data leakage. It's that somebody might find a way to use our API to extract details about our customer. And we spend a lot of time working with pen testers and with researchers from Cambridge University to make sure that never happens. And we're in a very fortunate position that, because we're a very young company and we're building a bank, and banks have lots and lots of money eventually, we don't right now, but eventually we'll have lots of money. And we're using very cool technology. Everybody wants to work for us. So we have people like throwing their CVs at us, like really amazing, amazing developers and really amazing security people. In particular, there's a guy called Daniel who joined us. He was an intern with us last year, and he's now joined us full time. And about a month ago, who here's got a Macintosh laptop? Okay, so about half of you, right? About a month ago, you had to reboot your computer. There was a non-optional upgrade, a security upgrade. That was Daniel. He found a CVE in OS X in Safari, and Apple made everybody in the world who has a Macintosh reboot their computer. He works for us. So, yeah. Yeah. More questions?
What do you use machine learning for?
Yeah. We will use machine learning for many things. Right now we use machine learning for fraud scoring, for working out whether or not you're likely to be a fraudster. We're going to use machine learning for credit scoring, like how much can we safely lend you. We're also using we also use machine learning to predict what your customer service query is about. So if you, It basically automatically tags and categorizes questions. Like if somebody says, "Hi, I forgot my PIN," it's very easy for it to say, like, "PIN request, here's the button for a PIN request." Yeah. But the interesting one is fraud scoring. Like that will, banks lose so much money to fraud. Like, it's just crazy. They lose about the same amount of money to fraud as they make in profits. They call it provisions. It's the reason why. Yeah, they lose so much money in fraud, and they don't really try to not lose money. They just like go, yeah, whatever, we lost 100 million, we made 100 million, whatever. But we have an opportunity because we have your phone, so we can ask your phone where you are. We can use machine learning to say, are you a normal type of customer? Like, do you have a normal profile? Like, do you spend money in about the same places where you live? Like, do you obviously have a job? Do you earn money? Like, do you look like a normal customer? And it makes it much less likely that you're a fraudster attempting to impersonate a customer to rip us off. So machine learning is really, really good for that.
So that's what we use
that for. Thank you. Unfortunately, time has finished, so.